I'll be happy this week, man, if we come away with if the sound was fantastic, right, and finally it clicks and bang, that is it.
Yeah.
That we get to come over a single or a couple of potential singles and a B-side, and then also maybe just some backing tracks or something. Do you know what I mean?
All the mics we've got up in the barn at the minute are open and up.
Right.
So that's right, we need to start now. Right, that's where we're at. Start off putting it back.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it sounds good at the moment, but it's got to sound fucking great. That's what we're looking for. Everything you ever do, it always builds up to something, you know. But for me, it's just like really fresh. I just think, I mean, from the floorboards up alone, it's just sort of fresh. It's just like, bang, you know, this is it. This is a new statement. This is where I'm at now, and away we go, you know, as is now, you know, that's the statement.
Paul said to me when we were driving across on a bus to Belgium last year, I want to make a record that just sounds like one piece. It just sounds like one continual piece.
Just buzzing again off playing live, you know, which I nearly always do, but even this time is even more. I just think we're getting better as a band as well, I really do. However old I get, I just think it's all getting better to me, you know. And I just thought, you know what, the kind of sort of songs we need as a live working unit. And we need a bit more rock and roll back in there, you know, because it's all got a bit mid-tempo in the last sort of few albums, a bit soft. And so I guess it was kind of geared towards that, not so much towards what I think my audience would like, even though, you know, kind of that is a consideration, obviously, but more what's going to work live as well, you know.
Best time to get a band in is after they've played 30 shows in 30 days, or you know, or 30 shows in 40 days. And you know, vocally sometimes it's not the best idea, but for backing tracks and for the band, it's without a doubt. You know, they've all been together, they're all playing together every night. So, and you can hear it. I mean, you totally can hear it. That's what I started with. The way we were going to make the record, I wanted to start in a classic, you know, an old school manner. But that would lead to great things.
I mean, I never thought I'd even get this far in life, to be honest with you. I'd have been happy just to make the first single, you know, when I was 17, when I was 18 or whatever. And, you know, someone said, oh, that's your lot. And I've just been quite happy to be doing this, do you know what I mean? And just gone back to playing little clubs in Woking, I suppose. But I mean, I'm glad, you know, I'm glad to have got this far.
You could sit back and rest on your laurels. He could do, you know, he could pull out all the old stuff and just make a big old greatest hits thing, and we could be the Rolling Stones or whatever. It's not enough for Paul.
No, something completely different.
After Illumination, which was my last studio album, well, last album that I wrote anyway, a few years ago, whatever it was, two or three years ago, I didn't write anything for a good sort of year and a half, you know, and I wasn't particularly upset by it either. I was just really had enough of it. I was bored with writing. And that's why I did the covers album. It was just like a nice release and a nice break away from writing and the pressures of writing an album. I would have kind of been happy to have not written again, you know, that's how I kind of felt anyway. Not every record's worked out, obviously, and well, I've made a couple of turkeys here and there, I guess, you know what I mean, if I'm really honest. But I would say I wouldn't ever consciously put a record out that was rubbish or, you know, substandard. I mean, and I wouldn't consciously play a gig that was substandard. I always try and do my hardest, and I don't know if that comes through to people, I don't know.
You've got to have a come down off something like Stanley Road, ultimately. And albums like Heliocentric, Heavy Soul, and Illumination, there's really good moments on them, but I think that ultimately when you go into the arena of having a successful album like Stanley Road was, I think there's got to be a downside to it, you know.
For those two, 3 years, it weren't happening, you know, for him. And he was the first to admit, it's not happening. I'm not feeling it. Feel I've been sleeping.
have looked, but I've never.
And I never really had a problem with that because I was always like, well, you know, one third of your ability as a musician is your songwriting, then there's your guitar playing, and there's your singing as well. So kind of, I see you in sort of three different lights. And that's been so fucking tough for him. Such a long time to be waiting in the sun.
But as fate or whatever, luck or whatever has it, you know, the kind of songs you say came to me, really. And I just feel I was just kind of like a little bit of a conduit for a lot of the tunes. And just kind of just sat down and wrote them down, you know.
He'll come in one day, and I just was at home last night watching the telly, but I kind of did this. And he'll play you a tune, and you go, hey? Where's that come from? I don't know. I really don't question it. I mean, he just kind of cracks on with it. I just have nothing but respect for the man. It's the start. It's a long time. Such a long time. To be waiting. The sun.
It's a bit clicky in here, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Not, I mean, it doesn't probably, it's just in the cans, I can only hear the.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I'll do a bit of work on that.
Okay. We should do another one, man. Music's universal, isn't it? Because music's one thing that cuts across any bullshit and cuts across any boundaries and cultural barriers, I'd say, really. And, you know, it really is a universal language, isn't it? And I think, you know, that's what always connects with people. That's why we're digging about African music or Indian music or music from Brazil, sitting in Woking in Surrey, digging Otis Redding, you know what I mean? It's not. It is a cultural thing in the sense that it's kind of, that it unifies us, I think, you know. And it's the sound of the earth as well, I think, especially in a lot of folk musics.
I don't know if that's the root.
To me, the sound of the barn's coming through. There's like a tough. There's a real toughness and a decay and stuff.
Yeah.
You're getting on that on the cymbals.
Yeah, just need to warm it up a little bit.
Yeah, I would still be happier if we had, that's the fucking drum sound, and that is it.
I just think it's four blokes just getting on with it, you know, and we're all sort of, as I say, we're all kind of dealing with the trials and tribulations of life, and we're not kind of in our ivory towers. There's lots of musicians get to that point and cover themselves in fucking memberships of shit clubs. We're just sort of still really massively intrigued by the process. We're still massively influenced by great musicians. And we're trying to aspire to something that keeps us all going. I don't think it's any more simple than that. I don't care if people don't get it, we get it.
All right, guys.